all we did was hit. it was very taxing on the body, to say the least. But I do think it helped us a lot. I mean, we were definitely tougher than any team we played. I'm gonna lie, I remember my freshman year, me and Sheldon Rankins were rooming in fall camp. And it was like day three, and I just walked in the room, looked at each other like, man, I don't know if I want to play football, though.
By Trent Guy. Trent Guy turns the corner. Guy breaks a tackle. Heads for the end zone. Touchdown. Charging, and he stays on his feet. Powell, how about this effort? Unbelievable run by Powell.
We're on a collision course with the national championship. The only variable is time.
Welcome into episode 7 of From the Pink Seats. Where are they now? I'm your host, Jacob Blaine, joined as always by my good buddy here, Vincent Lococo. And tonight we've got another great episode planned for you as another guest stops by for Where Are They Now? From the Pink Seats podcast. Subscribe anywhere that you get your shows from. Rate, review, do all that good stuff. Vincent Lococo, how are you, my friend? It's great to see you on a midweek episode, and we get to talk to a former teammate of yours tonight.
I'm great. It's nice to, you know, kind of be back in our regular flow of a Wednesday night recording, especially just us two with no Matt tonight as he ditches us for, you know, the other football sport. So, which is odd enough. I don't think he writes for Lou City, but it's whatever, Jacob. It's whatever. It's whatever.
DeAngelo Brown, a guest tonight on Where Are They Now? 107 career tackles, 22 tackles for loss, 5 sacks, 1 forced fumble, 1 fumble recovery. Played from 2012 to 2016. 2012 to 2016 is a long time to play football for Louisville. That's like modern day Louisville players who were there for 9 years.
He's had nothing but good football, man. That's like right. his entire time at Louisville was nothing but enjoyable football.
I would be interested to see where he stacks up in terms of, you know, one of the winningest players in program history, playing from 12 to 17 or 12 to 16, whatever I said.
He's got
to
be up there.
Yeah, man, absolutely. And one of the things that's really interesting about DeAngelo, and we'll get into this tonight on the show, is he played on a set of some of the best defenses in program history, from playing in the back half of the Charlie Strong era, and then also obviously playing for Bobby Petrino early on with Todd Grantham. And there's a lot of things to talk about with DeAngelo Brown, because a lot happened, a lot of winning happened primarily, but a lot of personal success, obviously a lot of team success, but there were some moments, some very key moments that will be really interesting to get DeAngelo Brown's perspective on. And of course, we'll dive into another edition of Screen Share and Rapid Fire tonight with DeAngelo to make this episode another one of the greats here on From the Pink Seats podcast. Vince, any last thoughts here before we jump into the episode with DeAngelo?
I mean, just how you mentioned it, I'm intrigued to hear his thought on, you know, these defenses. Cause I mean, I was only a part of a team with DeAngelo on the 2016 team. But those were some stacked teams with pass rushers out the wazoo, safeties that could come down in the box and play linebacker for you. Just so much, so many different things that Todd Grantham could do because he had the dudes out there on the field. That's one of those times, Jacobs, where we could like straight up out dude somebody. We didn't really need the right scheme or whatever. We could just line up, play ball, and win the game off of stellar defensive play and Lamar Jackson.
Hopefully those days getting back to that aren't too far ahead, man. But that's the hope here. And that's why we're doing this right now, is to get us excited and jazzed for the brighter days of Louisville football to come. Again, we can't thank you all enough for tuning into the show each week. It has been just a fantastic start to the series, and we'll keep it going for a few more weeks here before we get into the thick of things leading up to the beginning of the 2023 football season. Crazy enough, man, we're almost there. It doesn't feel like the offseason's been that bad. Really exciting stuff to get into tonight, and that's exactly what we'll do now as we welcome DeAngelo Brown into From the Pink Seats. Where Are They Now? All right, now we're excited to jump into the fun part of the show here. We welcome in our guest tonight. As I mentioned, episode 7, we're jumping back into the defensive line. You know, it's been a big theme of the show is defensive linemen. DeAngelo Brown, welcome into From the Pink Seats podcast. How are you, my friend?
Good, man. I appreciate y'all having me.
Yeah, of course. Well, we're excited to have you on. And as I mentioned, I think it's like third or fourth defensive lineman when you look back at Jonathan Grenard, Lozo, Devon Thomas, and now yourself. So I think that's a trend here. I like that. Gee, man, I know it's been a while since you played for Louisville, but as we mentioned, one of the most dominant defensive linemen that Louisville has had in a long time. We've got a lot to get into because really, you know, all you did was win, man. Like when you look back on it, is that kind of like that you could just hold on like to at the end of the day, like we just won football games no matter what.
Yeah, for sure, man. I tell people down here in Savannah all the time, like, y'all don't understand. When I was in college, we were ranked every year I was there, I believe. And, I mean, we won a lot of football games, got a chance to play with a lot of great dudes, a lot of talented people. So, man, I enjoyed it.
You're speaking of a lot of great dudes, and I guess I'll go ahead and we'll end up bouncing around the whole podcast. But I got to play a little bit with Lamar with you guys. You know, you also got a taste of Teddy too. What were the similarities between the two of those guys, and what was it like being on the field with both of them? I mean, they're two of the best quarterbacks in school history.
Oh yeah, man. It was at the time, I don't think I really realized, like, man, these two guys are like two Hall of Fame dudes that I'm playing with. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's crazy to be able to just play with both of those guys. I mean, both from South Florida, both great dudes off the field as well. It was a blessing, man. They're definitely the big reason why we're running a lot of games. I mean, it's just you don't have
come on now. Like that. Y'all, yeah. the defense, in my opinion, was, you know, yeah, I mean, yeah, L did his thing at quarterback in 16 and 17, but that defense in 16 that I was around was just one of the best ones, that easily the best one I've ever been around. Just dudes that fly around to the football, yourself at D-line, like the commanding force at D-line, and being able to watch Keith and Stacy just like move so freely was actually, it was pretty incredible.
Oh yeah, without a doubt, man. Now don't get me wrong, our defenses, every year I was there was great. I think my sophomore year, my redshirt sophomore year, every guy that was on that defense signed an NFL contract, which is just insane. We were good, man.
It's crazy to think back upon those days where it was just guys in the NFL all over the field, a bunch of guys still playing to this day. And it's just, it really has become night and day to where we are, but we'll get into that at another time. Let's talk about the challenges and some of the, you know, the unique, I guess, kind of parts of your career is going through the transition from Coach Strong to Coach Petrino. Obviously, we've talked with a bunch of guys who played for both, and they've kind of described how Coach Strong was, you know, and then versus how Coach Petrino was. But what was your transition like? What was it like going from Coach Bedford on the defensive side to Todd Grantham, and just kind of how was that transition overall?
I just looked at it as a challenge, really. I looked at it as a challenge to just reprove myself again, because I was hurt going into the 2014 season. I didn't play at all in 2013. So, I mean, Coach, I didn't have a lot of film to go off of. I played, I think, like 6 or 7 games my freshman year. So I really was trying to prove myself. But I think both coaches and both staffs were good. I think, you know, they're drastically different in a lot of different areas. But I don't know. I wouldn't say that's a bad thing. You know, just whatever floats your boat. So, it was, I feel like it was good. It was a good transition.
I love hearing like the guys, because I got Coach P from 16 all the way through 18. So I got to see it at like the lowest of the low. And yeah, when we were winning with you guys, everything was just sweet and peachy. I mean, he still gave his ass rippings and stuff. And 18, man, you felt every single one of them ass rippings from
sure. I'm sure, man. I genuinely enjoyed playing for both coaches. I enjoyed them both coaching me. They both coach hard. They both wanted to win, and I definitely can appreciate that for sure.
When did you start to feel confident on the defensive line? Because like you said, you got some playing time early and stuff, and then you felt like you had to reprove yourself. So was that coming in spring ball, fall camp? When did you start to feel confident in yourself as a player?
I really felt confident. It was my redshirt sophomore year. I think we played Boston College. And I had a great game. I think it had like 7 or 8 tackles or something like that. And I felt like my old self. And up until that point, you know, I missed the whole 2013 season, didn't get to play, you know, was just wanting to be out there with the guys bad. And I felt like that game just kind of flipped the switch for me. And we just took off from there.
Was it in 2012, obviously, you know, Louisville goes through the highest of the highs and getting to the Sugar Bowl and winning that. And then in 2013, when the year that you sat out with the injury, obviously not as the kind of the game that you wanted to in terms of the magnitude, but still finished with a very similar record. You know, obviously there was, you know, kind of looking forward to when Coach Petrino comes in, there was this, you know, continuation of all these guys continuing to be here and continuing to kind of carry that torch. But for you personally, seeing those two seasons under Coach Strong and you know, winning so many games, Kind of what did you take away, or kind of how did you allow that to mold you in terms of like, we got to win, you know, like, did that impact you seeing that? I know you didn't play a ton your freshman year, but just seeing it overall, did it kind of push you forward the next couple of years?
Oh yeah, for sure. I mean, that was the standard, you know, the standard was we're going to play great defense. We're going to score and we're going to win football games, no matter whatever it takes. So, I mean, that was the standard. And that was the mindset of all the guys going into that Coach Petrino era. I mean, we just knew how to win, and, you know, we just didn't accept losing. So it was great to just learn from a lot of the older guys and try to get my feet wet and learn from the guys around me. I mean, it was good.
Vince likes to ask this a lot, but just what was practice like, you know, 2013, 2012? I know obviously you dealt with the injury, but what were those practices like where you're talking about like 15, 20 NFL guys, man? I mean, it's like you could fill almost an entire starting lineup with just
I just remember guys. All y'all talking about just the amount of hitting y'all did, like, yes. Just how much just banging it was, just clacking all the time.
Yes, all we did was hit. it was very taxing on the body, to say the least, but I do think it helped us a lot. I mean, we were definitely tougher than any team we played, but I mean, it was a lot. I'm not gonna lie, I remember my freshman year, me and Sheldon Rankins were rooming in fall camp. And it was like day three, and I just walked in the room. We just looked at each other like, man, I don't know if I want to play football no more. But it was good, man. It was very intense, obviously, playing with and against a lot of guys that got a chance to play in the NFL. I mean, you know, it just raises your level of competition and raises the standards. So, you know, practices were tough, man. Practices were definitely much harder than the games, I'll say that.
What was it like? Because you guys were the last one of the last eras of just full two-a-days during fall camp. I don't think there was any real regulation. Might have been like 2 days on, 1 day off, like 2 days of two-a-days, and then you had to have 1 day off. So what were those like? Because I remember sleeping underneath the pool table, racing to get up to the players' lounge to get to that one couch on the side of the wall that everybody loved to sleep on. So yeah. What was that like for y'all?
It was tough, man. Really, it was a lot of mental stress, just trying to get yourself back up for another practice after we just practiced for two, maybe 3 hours that morning. It was tough, man. I'm not gonna lie to you. It was a lot. I do think that, you know, in some ways it helped, and I think in some ways it was hell. I'm not even gonna lie to you. It was hell.
But I'm curious, you mentioned Sheldon Rankins being your roommate. That's, you know, when you talk about defensive tackles playing together, I mean, you can't really have a conversation about Sheldon without mentioning yourself. You two were, you know, in terms of a pair, probably the most dominant interior lineman pair I've ever seen in my lifetime. I would be curious for people older than myself, but what was that like, man? I mean, obviously looking at where he is now, did you kind of realize that was coming for him? Like that he was going to be an NFL, you know, big time player when you all were coming up together, and how did you all kind of sharpen each other? You know, iron sharpens iron. How did you all get each other better and continue to push each other, you know, game after game, practice after practice?
Oh yeah. Without a doubt. I mean, I remember when we first got to Louisville, and I was the strongest in the weight room. Then we got ready to run. I'm like, I mean, I can move a little bit. I know I'm not the fastest, but I can move. And I remember lining up with Sheldon, and I'm like, this dude is just like 15 yards ahead of everybody as a D-tackle. I'm like, this ain't normal. This is not normal. So that's when I knew, like, all right, yeah, he's definitely gonna play a long time. But man, just we were best friends. Well, still are. We're best friends off the field. We talk a lot still. And obviously that translated to on the field as well, man. We push each other a lot. I work hard. He worked hard. And it kind of just molded on the field. Like, we had this thing when we were on the field together, we didn't have to talk because we spent so much time together off the field. Like, you know, if we saw something that the offense was doing or a formation change, we didn't even have to talk about it. We just automatically move. We automatically shift. It was great, man. It was great.
Talk a little bit about the X's and O's. I want to hear just a breakdown, right? So you and Sheldon are lining up side by side. What is he doing and what are you doing, right? Obviously, I know y'all are just moving the, you know, the F out of people in front of you, but what was the game plan on how he attacked and how you two worked together to attack simultaneously within the defense?
What was your all's favorite stunt? We'll say it that way.
Stunts, okay. I like that.
Anything like that.
Ooh, favorite stunt.
And you knew that, like, it was going to get home if you and Sheldon, if y'all ran it together.
Yeah, I would definitely say probably a star slug out of the nickel base, or if you remember that one. And probably Steeler out of base. I mean, just getting him moving with the way he moves and getting me to move a little bit. I mean, it was we knew somebody was going to make a play. If we didn't make it, I mean, we played with great guys. I mean, we had Devontae Fields, Keith Kelsey, Josh Harvey Clemens. I mean, we were loaded, man. I mean, if James Hearns, Trayvon, man. I mean, I could go on and on.
That's just the back half of your career, man. The front half is even more loaded than that. It really is crazy, man. I mean, it's just nuts.
We were talking about how before you were on in the intro, like how you could – that defense had the capability to bring Josh down into the box and play him so fluidly like a linebacker that it was almost a unfair matchup for that slot receiver to be matched up with Josh because he's so long and everything, and it's not like that slot's going to be able to block him on an edge or anything like that. You had 11 dudes you legitimately had to worry about either getting a sack, coming through on a stunt. And I mean, it was wild to watch you guys for sure. And in 14 and 15, Coach P was struggling with which guy he wanted to go at quarterback and stuff. So to us, it looked like the defense was holding everything down. Did you guys feel that responsibility and that pressure to kind of hold it down as the offense was struggling to find its footing?
Oh, for sure. I mean, the year before that, I think we may have been like the number one or number two. I know we were a top 10 defense the year before that. So going into that season, we already knew the defense was going to be the strength of the team. Like I said, we had all 11 guys on that 2014 team signed NFL contracts. So we already knew that, you know, we were going to be the base of the team. We're going to be the glue that held the team together. So we definitely felt like we did the best we could. We felt like we did a good job. But yeah, I definitely would say we were trying to hold it down for the offense.
You're shrugging your shoulders, Matt. You're talking to a guy that in 2018 won two games. We won two games, D-Lo. And you're like, oh yeah, we went 9-4 and 8-5. It's whatever. I mean,
it's interesting, though. I mean, because you're talking about Louisville building up to a legitimate national championship run, which we'll get to here in a second. But obviously, 2015 is where the quarterback situation starts to kind of turn itself around with Lamar Jackson getting footing and eventually becoming the starter late in the season. But it was that next season that it really starts to look up for Louisville is, you know, obviously the Syracuse and Charlotte games. I mean, Lamar had like 15 touchdowns and six quarters of action before the Florida State game, which we're definitely going to get into that. But I'm just curious, you know, we're going to talk about some of the allure of Lamar Jackson, but was there pressure playing with him, you know, during that run in 2016? Like when he is becoming the talk of every sports show, he is, you know, the face of college football for a season. Like, was there pressure on you all defensively or even just as a team to make sure that like you all weren't the reason that Lamar doesn't win a Heisman?
I wouldn't say that at all. I mean, our team, and Vince can attest to this, the 2016 team was just different, man. I felt like we were all very close. I felt like everyone had each other's back, no matter if you were a starter or backup. It didn't matter. Like, we all just were close and tight. And Lamar was part of that group as well. I mean, Lamar was a great dude on and off the field. We just wanted to get our job done. If we knew that he was going to take care of the rest. I mean, that was – we knew we didn't have to worry about scoring points. We just had to stop people. So.
Well, let me talk on that a little bit. You guys, you and Keith and Josh, all you guys, the old heads, y'all, you know, laid that foundation and made everyone so tight and made everyone, you know, come together. I remember numerous player only meetings where I'm like, oh fuck, D-Lo's about to go out there and talk. Like, hope I ain't doing nothing. It's stupid.
Yeah, man. Yeah, I think definitely that was something that was instilled in us from the guys that were before us. You know, the Brandon Dunns, Roy Fallons, Marcus Smiths, and Lorenzo Maldon, people like that. They instilled that leadership and that camaraderie within us, and we just kind of carried it on, man. It was great.
Louisville, obviously, I know you have the moments in 2012, 2013 with the Sugar Bowl, but Louisville is never like, you know, even when Louisville is ranked, they're not looked at as like an Alabama, Ohio State. You know, they're not, the top player is never up there with like some of the best in the country. They might be one of the best in the conference, but they're not one of the most talked about players in the country. You're talking about in this season, like all eyes are on Lamar and are on Louisville. For you all, you know, what was that like in the heat of that? Did you all feel legitimately we have a chance to play for a national championship?
I think that year for sure, after the Florida State game, we definitely felt like we could play for a national championship. I still felt like we could have played for a national championship that year without a doubt. We tried a couple plays that didn't go our way late in the year, but I mean, there was no doubt in our mind that we could not beat anybody that we played that year. I mean, we were very confident. Like I said, we were a very close team. And we definitely wanted to win for Lamar. I think that's another thing that's special about the team that year. Like, everyone wanted Lamar to win the Heisman. Like, we may have wanted him to win the Heisman more than he wanted to win the Heisman himself.
Yeah.
So I think that's just great. And that speaks volumes to the type of team we had.
Well, you keep talking about the type of team we had. Being the backbone of that defense, why don't you tell everyone kind of how you led? I got to experience it, you know, front and center. So tell everyone how DeAngelo Brown led that 2016 team.
I really just try to lead by example, man. Try to get the things on time, work hard, put in extra work, and really just kind of lead by example. I try to be a guy that anybody could talk to, whether you were there for 3 years or just got on campus. I try to be like, you know, a help to any young guy or any guy on the team. And I think my teammates can attest to that as well. I just try to really lead by example and do what I was supposed to do, and hopefully guys follow behind.
We tried. We all can't beat DeAngelo Brown, man. I mean, I want to ask him about the Florida State game week prep leading up to that. Over on the offensive side, I was on the scout defense, and we had, for a scout team wise, we probably had the best week of practice that we had collectively throughout the year. Coach P had to stop practice and made us go live, as a matter of fact, because the offense was just messing up so bad off the stuff we were doing. So for you guys on the defensive side, what was that week leading up to that game like?
I think by far that was the best week of practice that we had that whole season. Guys were really locked in. I remember, I think it was a Tuesday. After a Tuesday practice, everybody met up at one of our rooms that we were staying at, the whole defense, and watched film. After we just got done practicing and watching film, I mean, that just doesn't happen. Like, guys could have went home and did their own thing, but everybody was like, no, we're going to come together. We're going to watch more tape. We're going to hang out. And I mean, I think that's by far was the best week of practice we had the whole season as a defense.
For you all, like, what did it take to amaze yourself? Like, you all have for 3 or 4 years, you know, had the best of the best players. Like, what does that look like? Is it just flying to the ball at a different pace? Cause like, I was going to say, when we get to screen show, we're going to talk about this, but it felt like you all were literally playing on like endless levels of turbo. You know, on Madden, you eventually run out if you use it too much. Like, yeah. It felt like you all just were like on turbo boost the entire time, playing at a speed I've never seen Louisville play at. But what was it that would kind of indicate to you all, like, we just gave, like, this was our best week of practice? Because I would imagine for you, you've seen everything, you know, you've played with a lot of great guys. Can't imagine that week to week, it's hard to be like, well, that was the greatest week of practice I've ever seen.
Yeah. Yeah, for sure. I really think just when guys are, like you said, flying to the ball, and more so when guys are just focused, man, you're talking about 18, 19, 20, 21 year olds. I mean, it's a whole lot of stuff going on off the field, but when guys were really locked in and, you know, really just asking questions and being in tune in meetings and stuff like that. It's without a doubt, you can tell, you know, when everybody's locked in and ready to go. And I just felt like that week, guys were flying to the ball, guys were playing hard, guys were getting off blocks, guys were knocking passes down. I mean, everybody was just doing what they're supposed to do on and off the field.
So. Well, let me ask you this. And, you know, I didn't really notice any difference because I was 18, 19, and, you know, I'm young, I'm redshirting, so I'm not really, you know, paying attention to the different practices and stuff. Compare that week of practice to the Houston week of practice, where it seemed like everything for us kind of took a nosedive.
Yeah, I think part of that was just, I mean, we played, if you remember, we played Wake Forest that Saturday. I think the game might have ended at, what, like 10:30 at night. Then we had to come back and practice the next day again. I mean, it's kind of hard to ask guys who just got to play a full game to come back the next day and have another padded practice. Yeah. You know, and it's not the coach's fault or anything like that. We had a game to get ready for that
Thursday. Yeah, you just had to do it.
Yeah, you just had to do it. I just think that quick turnaround, and I really honestly believe just us looking at where they were ranking us, if you remember, I think they kept putting us like fifth in the college football playoffs instead of putting us in the top four. And I think guys were really like focusing in on that instead of just worrying about the game at hand. And it obviously showed that Houston week, because we played terrible.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you know, it's not every, you know, week you run into a top 15 pick, you know, on a Thursday night on short rest with a team hungry to come in and prove themselves. And I think Louisville had lost to Houston the year prior in 2015 too. I think I can remember Lamar threw like three interceptions or something that game. So it was always interesting to see those, you know, those Houston battles and what they looked like. And obviously they got the best there, but then it just kept kind of snowballing right into Kentucky and then into the season. So did you guys feel it? Like, did you feel the air slowly leaking out of the room on the season? Or was it always like, if we just work a little harder and get, you know, grind a little bit more, we'll be right back to where we were, you know, pre-Clemson or, you know, before Houston, really?
Yeah, the air definitely deflated fast after that Houston game. I'm not even gonna lie to you. It was at that point, it was like, all right, well, we're not going to the playoffs. So it's like, what's the point? You know
yeah.
What I'm saying?
Yeah. And now it feels like, you know, so, you know, a CEO coming and being like, no company raises this year. And everybody's like, all right, we'll see you later.
Yep. That definitely is how it went. I mean, obviously we wanted to beat Kentucky, should have beat Kentucky, but
the game was bullshit.
Yeah.
Bullshit, you know it.
I mean, just guys weren't, after that Houston game, guys just weren't locked in like they had been the whole season. I mean, it's hard. Don't get me wrong. It's hard to stay locked in for 12, 13 weeks in a football season. It's not easy. So, definitely after that Houston game, it was like, all right, well, good year.
Yeah, especially since, I mean, man, we're so close. We were really, really close. That Clemson game, I mean, just if, you know, Quick, obviously, if he stays in bound, or even if they call that pass interference on Cole, yeah. You know, like those are like two key plays. Like, man, what if, what would have happened? Would we have lost to Houston? Because we probably wouldn't have been paying that much attention to, you know, Final Four rankings and all that stuff.
Yeah, that's true, man. All of that plays a part for sure. I definitely think that Clemson game is the one that haunts me the most of my career. For sure, man. It's a lot of plays that we missed that, you know, wouldn't have got to some of those final plays that I think we could have avoided. But, I mean, they're a hell of a team, don't get me wrong, but I definitely wish we could line it back up.
That was the year. Yeah. I think that game, like, probably 8 times out of 10, I think we win that game. Like, offensively, we were better than them. Defensively, you guys could go toe-to-toe with them every single day of the week. So, I mean, really, it was just a toss-up kind of.
Yeah.
I mean, shit, it was at Clemson, so you know we're not getting any damn calls. How many times you get held that game, D-Love? Like, yeah, exactly. Yeah, right.
Truth comes out now. Now, on the other side, we're going to talk a little bit about post-Louisville NFL and then into what you're up to now outside of football. I'm really excited to do that. We'll do screen share as well when we get back on the other side of the break here. But the one thing I do want to ask about to kind of end this segment off and to really kind of put the bow on top of it is to talk about throughout that 16 season, you know, obviously you're coming off of a dominant season the year prior. You're looking to you know, come back with your brothers and put together a special run. But I would imagine in the back of your head, you're focused on making sure that your stock is constantly going up for the NFL. How much did that play a role into the season for you, if at all, in 16, and making sure that you didn't come back and hurt your stock more so than you did help it?
I think for me, it just was doing what I've always done and just continue to work hard. Put in extra work. I was a guy that always would do extra cold tub, Normatec, you know, take care of my body. I always felt like as long as I'm doing what I'm supposed to do, you know, everything else will work itself out. So,
I just thought you did that because you were old at the time.
My body was hurting. I'm not even gonna lie to you.
Then I hit, you know, 22, and I'm like, man, it all makes sense now. They wanted to be like, oh, they're treating it like a pro. No, y'all are just old and y'all were hurting.
Yeah. Very true. Very accurate.
Oh, my goodness. All right. I said that was the last question. This is the last question, and I say that because we're working with Luke Burgess and Madden Sanker, two Louisville offensive linemen now, on a show called L&M Eats, where we take them out to restaurants to try the great food of Louisville. So I got to ask you, what was your eating regimen as a 300-plus defensive lineman that moved like a dancer? Like, tell me what you ate and how you kept that body pristine to be able to do what you did.
I will say this, after my sophomore year when I got into my major of exercise science, I actually ate very clean. I ate a lot, don't get me wrong, but I ate very clean. Like, I ate a lot of vegetables, ate a lot of salmon, ate a lot of grilled foods. But on the weekends, whew, I'm not even gonna lie to you. I don't know if y'all ever been to Saints in St. Matthews.
Oh,
you know,
yeah.
You gotta get the halo wings with the blue cheese. You gotta get you a pepperoni pizza and the buffalo chicken dip. That was my go-to after every game.
Oh my god. See, he likes blue cheese with his wings, Jacob. Don't be judging me.
No, I'm not. I'm not.
See, he's a blue cheese.
I don't judge people that can beat me up, dude. That's not how this works over on this side.
So he just does it to me virtually because he knows I'm not in the same room as him.
No, but sounds fire. But I would imagine to keep yourself moved. Like, I'm not 300 pounds, but I feel like I move like I'm 300 pounds. Not like you did when you were playing defensive line, the wrong way. But yeah. I always am fascinated with what do defensive linemen who move like that eat? Like, how do you eat that much and not just eat junk, you know? So it's really interesting.
You bench 345 for like 20 times.
Yeah,
that's your workout. Then you can go eat that shit.
Burn 5,500 calories per practice those shoulder pads and helmets. All right, on the other side, we will come back and we will do screen share. We're going to look at the 2016 Florida State Louisville game. We're going to get D'Angelo's opinion in real time on what that game looked like. And then we'll talk about football after Louisville. We'll be right back on the other side. All right, we're back on the other side, and we are jumping into our favorite segment of the show here, Screen Share, where we watch highlights with our guests of a game, a big moment in their career. And today we get into the Wayback Machine and go back into 2016 in a game that I will never forget. I worked for iHeartRadio at the time, and I was out at the stadium at 3:30 in the morning with everyone lined up to get into College Game Day. D'Angelo, what was the morning like for you on this day in September in 2000 or in October? Over in 2016, what did you all wake up? What time did you get to the stadium? How did that go for you and your College Game Day experience?
It was really just a normal game day for us. I mean, we had our normal breakfast downstairs, meetings, car march at the stadium. I mean, just was we treated it kind of like a normal game. I think Coach Petrino definitely wanted to emphasize not getting into the hoopla, as he would say. I think he definitely wanted to keep us focused, which he obviously did. We went out and did what we were supposed to do. So,
yeah, I definitely didn't wake up, you know, possibly hungover, you know, because I was redshirting and I wasn't going to play, so I could do that. And, you know, enjoyed College Game Day a little bit from the couch and watched some TV of it. And then I went to the stadium.
There you go, man. All right, we'll dive in here. Like I said, this is a short one, a minute and 44 seconds, so we'll have some fun here. But Lamar Jackson, that was obviously the story coming into it because he had those two games against Charlotte and Syracuse, and you got number two Florida State, DeAndre Francois. This is right after Jameis Winston, so big shoes to fill. The one defensive highlight they show is a touchdown, man. I can go back here. Do you remember this one of the only touchdowns of the day? Do you remember?
He had two sacks in the game, and you want to talk about that?
Double teamed him, man. Look at this. They gave him no chance. They double teamed him almost immediately. What do you remember this play right here?
Let's see. I actually do not. To be honest with you, I don't even remember him scoring a touchdown. I do not remember that.
Dude, that's ultimate flex about right there.
I forgot about Johnny Richardson. I forgot about him. Y'all had a squad that year too on the defense squad.
Yeah, and again, it's a lot of offensive highlights, mostly Lamar. This right here, though, man, this is a catch for a guy who never played football. This is what I'm talking about, right? You catch it between your knees when they show it again. It looks like he's pooping the way he's sitting. Just, I mean, you couldn't do this again if you tried. But it was that type of day for you all. I mean, it really was. And then every hole opens up for Lamar. I mean, it was like, again, they were in quicksand and you guys had extra turbo. I've never seen Louisville move with that speed.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, man. I think this punt return is when we knew, like, all right, the game's over. It's a wrap.
Yeah. That was definitely the best Sunday film session
of
all time. That was so fun. Going into that one, man.
People couldn't wait to get to the stadium that Sunday.
Trevion Samuel, what a blast from the past. I forgot about him until I was watching the highlights here. One of the guys I wish we could do over his career, man. Really would have been a nice fit. Got the ball a little bit more. I don't know, D'Angelo, do you have any thoughts on, you know, the two sacks, your defensive performance? Obviously, the highlights here don't show you dominating the game like you did, but for Florida State to score as few points that they did, you all did your job and you did it really well. Were there any kind of big takeaways for what you all did to attack them?
Man, really just going into the game, our whole mindset was not just to win, but as a defense, our mindset was to dominate. I mean, we wanted to really shut Dalvin Cook down. I really think we did that game. I mean, that was our whole mindset going into the game. So I felt like that was one of the best games we played as a team that whole season, man. It was great. It was a great feeling.
What does it feel like to have 50,000 people screaming and yelling? I know a lot of Louisville football players here lately haven't gotten to feel like the full stadium packed. It's been a couple of years. What was that like, especially against in that game? Like, can you describe that feeling you get from the fan base?
Oh, it's great, man. Our fans, when we're winning, they're electric. I mean, when we just back in those days, I mean, I think almost every game, not almost every game, but a lot of our games were sold out. I mean, we had a lot of people in the stands. Everybody was into the game. It was great. It was a great feeling. Really made you feel good.
What was the first thing you noticed? Like, did you see like people start climbing the wall whenever they were flooding the field that game? Like immediately, when did you start to notice that? Like, oh shit, we're having a moment here.
Probably when I got like midway to the field, I'm like, oh shoot, people coming on the field. Like, I've never seen that before in one of our games. I mean, I didn't. At first, I'm like, are they really about to do this? And then more and more people started coming. I mean, it was great, man. It was a great experience. It was a great moment, something I'll never forget.
But people always get hurt doing that too. Like I can't remember who we discussed it with, maybe John. But I mean, I saw a lady break her ankle during that one, and then I saw somebody tear their ACL whenever we'd be Wake Forest. Like, so people always get hurt doing that stuff.
People that look like me trying to do athletic things, man. That's what happens, Vince. When you don't have an athletic bone in your body, you tear your ACL trying to jump off of the wall into the field. Let's talk about. After Louisville, obviously you go into 2016, as I mentioned, looking like an NFL draft prospect, a top 25 defensive tackle in the draft, which typically that puts you somewhere in the seven rounds. But what were workouts like? What was pro day like? You know, what was your kind of thoughts heading into the draft and what the outcome might be?
My mind was really just open to any situation, any scenario. I saw a bunch of different things, you know, for me going this place, that place, but I really just tried to make sure that I was doing what I was supposed to do and letting everything else work out. And just wherever I landed, just try to make the most out of whatever opportunity I got.
Did you think was it even a question that you were going to be drafted? Like, was there any thought going into that the scenario of seeing yourself fall out of the seven rounds?
I definitely thought I was going to get drafted. It wasn't a doubt in my mind that I was. I thought that I had a great career. Thought I played, had a great season. But that draft is more to it than just that. so, you know, they look at height, weight, speed, and all that other stuff. And there's some things I just wasn't blessed with. I wasn't blessed to be 6'3", 6'4", and I don't run fast.
Yeah, I mean, you can bench a house though. Let's not discredit you. I'm sure you still have that crazy, stupid strength that you had whenever we were in college.
Oh yeah. I'm still lifting, still very active. So, but yeah, man, everything worked out. I'm happy with everything.
So tell me about what it was like going into the Titans organization and going through the offseason and how that process all played itself out to ultimately you deciding to walk away from football. What was that timeline like for you?
It was a great experience, man. I got to play with and against some of the greatest athletes in the world. It was a great experience. I really enjoyed it. I felt like I gave everything I had in every practice and every preseason game that we played. So I don't have any regrets, man. It was a great time.
Was it like when you're going through, you know, camp in the offseason, rookie camps, you know, did you feel pretty good about your chances to be able to make a team, or was it, you know, always an uphill battle because of some of the intangibles that you mentioned? Obviously, there was no question. Your production was there. You've got the ability, you know, you've got some of the things that you look for from a defensive lineman, but you did mention there were some things that they wanted that maybe you just couldn't offer. So did you know, or were you kind of feeling like you had the chance all along to continue to play?
Oh, I definitely feel like I had a chance. I mean, I felt like I had a great camp. I was very productive during camp. I made a lot of plays. Didn't really make a lot of mistakes, but just it's a numbers game, man. It's a numbers game. It's a money game. It's just a lot more that goes into it than just being a good football player and stuff that's just really out of mind and a lot of guys control. So
transitioning from that, why don't you tell us about DB97 training? and how that is, how you got started doing that, when you started doing that, and what it's looking like now.
So I started in 2018. Actually, one of my teammates from the Titans, Carl Clue, his brother, does this in Nashville, Tennessee. And I was like, this man travels with a van and works people out. I said, oh, yeah, I'm doing that. I am doing that when I get done playing football. And so when I got done, man, I moved back to Savannah. I started off slow. I kind of wanted to grow my business with as my clientele base grew. And I mean, now I've got around 100 clients. I trained some of the top high school recruits in the United States. I mean, it's a blessing, man. I train a lot of people from older adults to kids. So I train a wide group of people, but man, it's a blessing to work with a bunch of different people and just try to get them in shape.
Man.
So are you putting them through those Coach Madej workouts? Are you implementing more Coach Strong workouts? Are you mixing both of them? Are you giving the 80-year-old grandma the same, you know, treatment that you're giving the 17-year-old kid?
No. Graham's definitely not getting the Madej or Strong workout.
Oh, my God.
I want to make money. I got to fight too. But no, my high school kids, they get after it, man. They're working out with their high school, and after they get done with that, they come to me and we get it in. I've trained about six or seven kids that are definitely play Power Five football. I'm just happy to be a mentor to them and try to, you know, share my experiences with them and, you know, help guide them and get them ready.
Man, what a life that is. So you get an average Joe like me, right? And I come to you and I say, D'Angelo, man, I want to be ready to play in an adult football 7-on-7 league. And I want to be, you know, the Lamar Jackson of this league. You got 5 months. Can you get me there, man? Like, can you get me to be able to not saying let me be Lamar Jackson, but could you get me an average Joe in shape and ready to play football?
I was about to say, I'm going to be upfront and honest with you. Anywhere close to Lamar Jackson is a hell no. But I will do my best to get you in good shape. So that would be all I got for you.
Oh my. So what's kind of the stuff that you have in the van, man? Like what kind of equipment and stuff does that consist of? Is there any in-van workouts or anything like that? You know, close the door, arm farm, extra sweat or whatever?
Man, I've got everything. So I've got racks, like squat racks in there. I've got bars. I've got dumbbells that go up to 100 pounds. I've got medicine balls, battle ropes, plates, like everything a gym would have except for cardio equipment and machines I have. So, man, it's really cool. I set up at parks, and my clients that I train in-home, I'll set up at their house. I mean, I'll set up just like a gym, and we get after it. It's really good. I enjoy it.
That's wild. Jacob, I don't know about you, man, but that seems like a pretty cool career path to go down. And what made you – so that guy from the Titans was kind of what inspired you to go down the training route? I mean, what was your degree at Louisville?
My degree was exercise science. Initially, I wanted to be the physical therapist. Uh-huh. Coach Petrino actually got me a internship with one of the top physical therapy places in Louisville.
Oh, so he does nice things.
Yeah. He did a lot of good things for us. I won't lie. He did a lot of nice – things for me, I should say. I wanted to just go a different route. And I loved working out. I love helping people. So that's definitely something I wanted to get into. So,
where are you at now? You know, you were at 300 pounds whenever you were playing. I doubt you're, you know, moving around at 300 something again still, or are you?
Man, I'm 255 right now.
Oh my gosh, that makes me feel like a fat ass. All right, I'm going to go hit the treadmill after this podcast, guys. I'm done drinking beer for like a month. And I need a dietitian now.
Yeah, man. It definitely was a hard transition being somebody who ate a lot of Saints wings in St. Matthew. It was tough. Y'all think I'm joking. Saints has some of the best wings I have ever had.
Oh my God.
That's incredible, man. That's incredible. It's funny that you say that. And that's a great transition into the last segment of the show here, the rapid fire questions. That was one of my first questions, is what was your favorite spot to eat? But we can go ahead and take that one off of here because you've answered that one with a resounding. It's Saints and St. Matthews.
We'll start here. What is, and this might be a little bit of a silly question or a far one out there, and it might take a little bit, but what fan base or what was the funniest smack talk or chant you heard to either your team or to yourself as a player when you all would go out on road trips?
That's a tough question. I mean, you talking about on the field or off the field?
Either one, man. Because, I mean, obviously nowadays, right, it's L's down everything with Kentucky. That's what the guys see everywhere. But I wasn't sure with Lamar or with Teddy, you know, if there was, you know, back in the day, it used to get heated with the West Virginias and the Cincinnati's, you know, the Miami fans even coming up here and getting a little rowdy. But I would imagine that some fans probably talked some crap to you all along the way.
Oh, yeah, they definitely did. I would definitely say the lame L's down thing was probably – the most memorable. Just I don't understand why they think we care that they're throwing the L's down. Like, it's just so stupid to me, but probably that for sure.
Okay, so who was the one offensive lineman that you hated going up against in college?
Definitely John Miller. Without a doubt, dude was just as strong as me. We had some battles. He was good.
If you could go back, I know you mentioned a couple earlier, but if you could get one mulligan for a game at in your Louisville career, what game would you reverse the outcome?
Not Clemson or Houston.
Oh, that's a tough one, man. Because I mean, he only lost like two other career games.
All right,
you took my number one choice. I would probably say Florida State. My sophomore year. I think we were up like 21-7 at halftime, and
yeah, man,
I don't know what happened. We just
Jameis Winston happened, man.
Yeah, that's true.
I stand by that's one of the greatest performances I've ever seen from a quarterback, besides Lamar, of course. I mean, yeah. That was incredible. Him and Dalvin Cook. But hey, you had mentioned like in 2016 when we got to shut Dalvin Cook down, because in the second half of that game, it was crazy.
Yeah, it was insane.
What's the funniest phrase either your position coach, Coach P, or Charlie use that you remember?
It's a lot, but I don't know if I can say them on air.
Yes, you can. You can. No, I'm the boss here, man. Say whatever you want.
Actually, it was Coach. I don't know if you guys remember Coach Sean Watson. He was there my freshman year. I think he was the offensive coordinator. Mm-hmm. I think something happened. He just walked upstairs with this calm look on his face. And I won't say the word. He just looked at everybody. And he was like, "So it's F me, huh? F me." He's like, "What is she talking about?" He was talking about something that happened at practice. And he just kept saying it. Oh, man. I will never forget that. It just was so funny.
That's great. All right, man. As a big guy, I would have to imagine, or at least I hope that in that bag, you got a go-to celebration. So when you're getting a sack or you're scoring a big man touchdown, what's the go-to move?
I just always go crazy, and then I would regret it because I'd be more tired than I was before I did. I'm like, why am I doing all this moving? Just go back to the huddle.
You're such a big, guy.
That is total big man energy right there. Yeah. Getting tired, celebrating. I feel like me and all 500 of my chubby friends can relate to that.
Yeah, man. Definitely was the fist pump, or just, you know, talking trash or something like that. Then I'm like, why did I just do that? I just wasted breath.
Favorite college road trip.
Ooh, I would say probably the bowl game my senior year when we played LSU, and mainly because that was my last.
That was fun.
Game. Yeah, last time with my teammates, last college football game ever. So. It was very memorable. I remember a lot of my friends from Savannah came up and got to watch me play in my last game. So definitely that one for sure.
That game was wild. I mean, Jamal Adams could cover the entirety. I was telling Jacob, they could have played like 10 on 11 on the offense and they would have been fine, because Jamal was just covering sideline to sideline literally the entirety of the game.
Oh, yeah. He was floating.
That was the Darius Geis Creaky game too. Remember that one?
Yeah, man.
Yeah, that was a fun trip though. We had a great time that week. They had the Lazy River. Remember, that was awesome. Yeah. That was a hit with the guys.
Oh yeah.
Man. That was basketball. Fun. Y'all had some intense basketball. You know damn well I wasn't getting in that shit. But y'all had some intense water basketball games that week too.
Oh yeah, it was fun, man. We had a good time for sure. Yeah.
Man, incredible stuff. Well, that's the trip down memory lane. Where are they now with D'Angelo Brown? D'Angelo, thank you so much for joining the show. And for the folks in Savannah, man, I need to get on Zillow and look at the listings, because I need DB97, man. I need to get back in the best shape of my life. I need that right now. But thank you so much for coming on, man. And best of luck to you with everything you got going on, brother.
Thanks, man. I appreciate y'all having me. Vince, good to see you, man.
Yeah, good seeing you too, bro.
Yes, sir.